All right. So I just want to make sure everybody's able to see my screen right now. Move this
guy. Good, Brandon.
Fantastic. All right. And there we go. Let's get that guy. So for those of y'all who don't know me, my name is Brandon Karr. I'm the former Air Operations Integrations Coordinator for the City of Pearland. I started the Pearland Police Department's drone program back in 2017 and grew it into one of the most recognized drone programs in the world. I am an internationally recognized subject matter expert to utilize drones for law enforcement disaster response. So we've utilized these mapping features for not only crash crime scene reconstruction, arson investigations, but also disaster responses and things of that nature. I'm currently the solutions engineer team lead for DroneSense, co-founder for Unmanned Tactical Group, and chief operating officer of the Law Enforcement Drone Association. So one of the biggest benefits for utilizing mapping stuff is that aerial photogrammetry. You have the ability to do fast scene documentation. You can do 3D reconstruction and mock-ups, which create powerful deliverables for the stakeholders that you may be utilizing these things for, right? So one of the ways that y'all may be giving this information out is, so from a disaster response perspective, is to quickly show what roads are open, what roads are not open for the entire disaster response area. From a crash reconstruction perspective, is to show what those measurements look like, those analytics for any type of major incident that you're trying, or any type of crash or criminal investigation that you're trying to show where things were positioned and how are they positioned. As well as being able to utilize the mapping features in DroneSense to be able to create physics engine things and things of that nature. So what does a crash scene workflow look like? First and foremost, you're going to do all of your life-saving measures and scene security as always, right? Next, you're going to determine your scene extents. And you really want to make sure that you talk to whoever was first on scene to say, where did this start? Where did this end? So that way, whenever you do your mapping mission, you know you have your entire scene inside of your mapping plan. So one of the things that I like to do whenever I make first contact with that individual is I'm going to get my drone turned on. I'm going to get everything up and running like I'm ready to fly. I'm going to place my drone where the drone began, and I'm going to walk to the other side of the crash scene. And the reason that I want to do that is on your DroneSense program, you'll be able to see where your drone is located and you'll be able to see where your GPS location is of your remote. So what that does is it says, okay, here's how big my scene is. Now when I build out my map plan, I know exactly how far I got to go. Next, you'll place your ground control points or your known measurements, painted points of interest, whatever you would like to do. And then last but not least, from a on scene perspective, you're going to create that flight plan. Right. So that's where you're going to choose. Are you going to do a grid search? Are you going to do a 3D grid? Or are you going to, if it's a search for person type operation, build out, figure out how big of an area I'm going to start searching and how what type of flight plan I want to utilize that's going to optimize my opportunity for success there. Once you've created your flight plan, after that, you can fly that flight plan, capture all the data that you have, capture known measurements and ground control points, and then last but not least, validate the data. The way that I have my my monitor set up, if somebody does ask a question, I'm not going to see it. So you just keep an eye on that and flag me. Appreciate you, buddy. Coming into validating the data, this is huge. So after you've done your flight, before we leave the scene, go through the photos in the media manager there and make sure that they're not underexposed, overexposed, have motion blur, things of that nature. Because if you were to utilize those photos in the post-processing side of the house, all of the mapping software struggle with underexposed, overexposed, or motion blur photos, things of that nature. Okay. Fantastic. Awesome. So moving forward, we have a few different options for you to be able to do those mapping missions. So regardless of it, whether it's for a crash scene or if you're just trying to do like a search of person, you can utilize these autonomous features all you want for multiple different things, right? So the first one we're going to talk about is waypoint missions, right? So think of waypoint missions as the ability to be able to tell the drone, hey, I want you to fly this path, right? Like really good for search and rescue options, really good for if you're wanting to patrol a certain area, things of that nature, you can do that. So first and foremost, you can set the flight plan name to be whatever you want. Select the aircraft for whatever you want. Select under actions your waypoint. You can choose your speed that you want to select, the altitude in which you want the drone to also fly at. So again, make sure that you are going to be at an altitude that is legal for your operations. Next, you'll select add to plan, and then you'll have the ability to go in and edit that, and you can build out all kinds of different waypoints positions, however you would like to do that. You can just add different waypoints going on and so forth. Okay. Any questions on the waypoint mission at all? And again, this could be as many of those waypoint missions as you want. As you can see, we have one and then we have two. So you just add in which ones you want. It's important to also note that you can do varying altitudes, right? So if you wanted to continue to just add more and more, you can set those altitudes and it'll make those climbs and descents. Okay. Again, guys, this is a training opportunity, so don't hesitate to ask any questions that you may have, guys. We want to make sure that everybody has all those questions answered properly. Okay. Once you're done with the waypoint mission, you just hit go now. Once you hit go now, the drone will take off. It'll fly to that waypoint one, waypoint two, waypoint three, so on and so forth. Or if you want it to only go to a specific point, don't want it to go to one, you want it to go direct to two, you can do that as well. Okay. As you can see, the drone will take off and it will fly that waypoint mission. Okay, so again, from a waypoint side of the house, these are really good for security. If you're wanting to run a specific path on a perimeter, it's really good for search and rescue. If you want to search a certain area, that way you can tell the drone to go do a thing and you can just focus on the camera payload, right? There's a few different benefits to utilizing it this way. Okay. Beautiful day up there. Awesome. Any questions at all? If not, we'll jump to the next one.
No questions yet, Brennan.
Fantastic. All right. So that was waypoint mission. Next, we have orbits. So one of the ways that you'll want to utilize orbits are for multiple different applications. So for example, whenever I'm doing crash reconstruction, I like to do a 2D or a 3D grid at altitude. And then I like to do orbits around my final rest or my focal points on my my area. The other way that I like to utilize orbits are potentially if I'm wanting to just set that guy and forget it and just do operations around a fixed point, like if there was a structure fire or a SWAT scene, things of that nature, and I'm wanting to get multiple vantage points at all times, orbit is a really good way to do that. So in the exact same manner, you're going to go into your flight settings up in the top left-hand corner. You can name it whatever you want. Again, so this can be DroneSense Orbit. It could be the case number. It could be anything that you want it to be. Select Orbit. And then, as always, you can just select on the map where you want it. You can select the radius of that, however big or small you would like that to be. Set the speed of the orbit, the altitude of the orbit. And if you'll notice at the very bottom where it says radius there, you can adjust that there as well if you don't want to use the slider on the map. So a few different options there for you. Okay. Just want to let this play through so y'all can see what that looks like. There we are. We can go massive or we can stay short with it. Full disclosure, when it comes to crash crime scene reconstruction, I typically don't like to use autonomy for the orbit simply because those cars typically don't crash in a nice open field for me. They're typically up against a light pole or they're up against a telephone pole or into a wood line, things of that nature. So I have to fly it manually on a semi-orbit anyway. So if you want it to take photos, you can toggle that on and off. Or if you do want it to take photos, you can toggle it on and it'll do that for you. Once again, once you are ready for it to take off, you just hit the play button, hit go now. And at that point, the drone will take the flight plan in. It'll activate, launch the aircraft, and then it will fly to the call for service and start that orbit. Any questions on that at all?
No questions.
Y'all making this way too easy on me, guys. There's a lot of people in this room. And awesome. A lot of people said y'all have not used it. Y'all made this way too easy on me. No, come on with those. Coit's a prime example of it, man. Like whenever I was just learning to do this, I was asking Coit questions all the time.
And now I ask Brandon.
No shame in the game on that one at all. Okay. So again, drone will take off, fly there. It'll hit that orbit, and it'll just stay in that orbit. Dadgummit, sorry, I hit my scrolling button on my remote or on my mouse there. Okay. This is a new feature that we have. It's called the sector search. So this is extremely good for search and rescue events. So we designed this at the request of the Norwegian Police Department, who did a really big study on the efficiency of this and some of the fines that they had. This increased their apprehension and person locate statistics, which was really good. So this is something that you may want to look into as well. What it will do is it'll initially drop down what's called a bicycle wheel or a pinwheel search tactic. So you'll get to see what that looks like. So again, in the top right hand or top left hand corner, you'll just select the sector search there, add to plan, and it will drop that pattern that you saw there in there. And you can adjust the radius on this. So this is really good to utilize because you get multiple different angles of attack over that search area. So if they're up against a tree or if they're up against a building and you did a parallel search or a waypoint search or during your hasty search, you may have not gotten the proper angle of where that individual was located, whether that's a suspect or a missing person. This will allow you to attack it from a bunch of different angles that will help with your success. Generally speaking, from a search and rescue perspective, you want to try to get those angles to align with a street or a roadway for paths of least resistance, just because that's likely where the suspect will end up being or the missing person will end up being because humans are lazy and they like to take the path of least resistance. So as always, name it whatever you want. Once you have saved that, you can fly it for another day or you can hit go now, select the point that you want it to launch from. Once you hit go now, the drone will take off and it'll begin to fly that sector search. So it'll fly to that center point of that circle, and then it will start those different angles there. Okay. And so again, this one's optimized for search and rescue. This isn't really a crash crime scene reconstruction flight plan that you might utilize, but in the event that you want to try it out, I'd love to hear what your findings were on that. But generally speaking, from a crash recon, I typically like to do manual operations.
Hey, Brandon, we got a Joe just threw out a question here. It says, can you rotate the circle to align with the roads and paths?
On sector search, I don't believe you can, simply because going in through the menu here, the only menu item that we had was just to be able to place it. But that's something... Yeah, there doesn't look like there's any more. That's not scrollable there. So it doesn't appear that we have the ability to change the course angle, but you can try to change the location of that sector. You could change the width of it as well, which will change the sizes and paths that might attack. Great question, Joe.
Brandon, I thought was great when we were in Houston together, and we were looking at this from the they had the crewed aviation folks that have been doing this for some time now with their pre-planning of the aircraft. It's really neat to see this move over to the drone side of the house. Understanding this came from Coast Guard, is that right? Was
correct, yeah.
Maritime operations initially?
Yeah, just about all of the, when it comes to search and rescue or search or aerial search patterns, almost all of them came from Coast Guard. There's a really fantastic old as hell document, but it's tried and true. It works. That's where you're going to see parallel search. You're going to see the sector search. You're going to see contour searches for mountain ranges, right? That's where you're going to find all those expanding square search, expanding circle search. This was called the pinwheel search back in the day for Coast Guard. It's been adopted to the bike wheel search because there's been, technology has advanced and search tactics have advanced over time from when the Coast Guard initially wrote a document up on this. But it does work. So highly recommend people give it a shot.
Is there anybody on this call that has, in fact, used this technique? Like, you get any coasties on here or anybody that's used it? And then Joe just threw out, is there any value to pictures from the sector search for PIX4D mapping? I don't think we can process those.
It can. Joe, that's a fantastic question. In my opinion, and that's take it for what you want, not really. Now, there would be a value to that if you were wanting to dump these type of photos into like a software that can search for certain palettes, like Texas Echo Search has an open search software where you can put in like the suspect or the missing person was last known wearing a gray shirt. You could type in the palette and it'll scan those photos, and then it will drop a marker on the map on where that color palette was found. There's also Locate, Eagle Eyes. There's a bunch of different software. So like specifically for Pix4D, not so much, because all that's going to do is create a map for you, and you could go in and squint it, which is fine. That's not a bad tactic, but it, in my opinion, it's not. I think you'll be better. I think you'll be better valued in utilizing, like Locate, Eagle Eyes, or elsewise. Yeah, John, give me one second. Let me find you, and I'll unmute you. Here. There you go, John. You are allowed to talk. There you go.
Hey Brandon, can you hear me?
I can, yes, sir.
So when Sector Search first came out, we started testing it with our search and rescue people, and it works perfect. From what we can tell so far, we'll be out again next week doing some more training with it. But so far, we're liking the Sector Search for those missions. And also, they do export well into CalTapo, so you can export the file into CalTapo.
From an ortho perspective or from a KML?
Well, we're downloading, I believe it's through a GPX.
Okay. Yeah. From the, okay. So, yeah. So to John's point, all of these flight plans that you all create, any type of autonomy or even in a hasty search perspective, in post, you can export out any telemetry in a GeoJSON, JPX, or a KML file. So if this was a search and rescue type deployment, you would be able to utilize that KML to show where you have searched, right? Where you have not searched, to be able to increase your efficiency for that search and rescue event. Yeah, fantastic point. And that happens often. So like we were running an air operation. We had a search and rescue event down here in the Galveston Bay for Chief Reed for Kima. He got knocked out of his boat. Unfortunately, he drowned, and it was a massive event. But like Coast Guard was exactly doing that with their Dolphin helo. They would literally build out their flight plan for the day in each sector and search it, and we'd be able to see what where they flew, how they flew, and we were able to fill the gaps utilizing drone teams. So really
Exactly.
beneficial there to John's point.
Yeah, that's exactly what we were doing is filling in with ground crews.
And don't forget also, if y'all don't have CalTopo, SARTopo, things of that nature, utilizing MSAT or ATAC, there's a lot of different software that you can utilize out there that can really help enable your efficiency and effectiveness in doing search and rescue events for integrating in your ground personnel, your aerial personnel, and then your crewed aviation personnel.
Hey, Brandon, Matt Rowland put in a question here, or a chat, I think it was. One of our pilots commented they did not like that the radius size is related to the altitude.
So the radius size is related to the altitude
Yeah. For
for
sector
sector
search.
search or for.
Yeah, for sector. So his example is searching in a large area, the altitude would be higher than 400 feet. Instead, he has to do several smaller searches. That
Right.
is
Corey,
something.
I think I sent that as a support ticket, and I
Let
gave it
me
to
see.
David Sprague also.
I believe you have.
Because
I
that was one
remember.
thing we noticed right off the bat.
Yeah.
Sorry about that. I hit the roller, or I have a touch mouse, and God, is it touchy. I hate this thing. I got to get a new one. Matt, thank you for that. So Coit and I will dive into that. We'll try to
Yeah,
figure
so
out.
something that John had mentioned before, and I totally, it's just been off radar.
So let me get back online to this thing. I apologize for dropping it. I was in sector search. we are. There's Zoom. There we go. All right, we should be back up and running. Yep, okay. Yeah, Matt, thanks for that. Out of curiosity, man, did you drop a ticket on that one, on the altitude restrictions?
I don't think he dropped
it. I think I did it early on when we first released Sector Search.
Okay, John. John, we can do is we can go in and find your ticket, and we can duplicate it to Matt's just so there's a second ticket for requests.
Helps yep. with the process. Yeah, as you expand it out, it pushes you over that 400 AGL.
That's a good point. Okay. Thanks for that. Appreciate it. Awesome. Coming on down. Next one. We also have surveying. So this one, dadgummit, this looks like the wrong video. Yep. Let's see. Oh, no, it's the right one. You just did it separately. Survey is going to be the flight plan that you'll utilize the most for crash reconstructions. They're also really good for mapping out a massive area so that you have an updated footprint if the satellite imagery is old, or if you want to start squinting areas. This is really good for mapping those large areas out. So think of this as, you know, you've done your initial hasty search, you've done some sector searches, and you're not finding the individual. So at this point, you're going to go into and you're going to map out that whole area, dump that stuff into Locate, Texar, you know, Eagle Eyes, whatever other software y'all may be utilizing for that kind of stuff. Okay. So in this one, just like before, you're going to hit that hamburger in the top left-hand corner. And then from there, you will select your flight planning mission for survey. You can adjust the polygon to be whatever you want. If you were to select the white dots, you can make the adjustment even more, add legs just as such. On the left-hand side over there, we have all the information associated with that survey, right? We do have some presets in there for Pix4D React, 3D Ortho, search and rescue events, and those are really good pre-fills. If you're not sure what you're doing, utilize those. Typically, I end up having to make my own adjustments for my own stuff, but again, they're really good baselines. Make sure you scroll down. You can adjust the speed of your aircraft, the altitude of your aircraft, and as you'll notice, it'll automatically adjust the flight plan for you. You also can make adjustments on ground sampling distance, and we'll talk about what that is here in a minute. Okay. Once you have gone in, you can also adjust the overlaps and make sure that you have enough overlap to capture enough data so that if you did put it into a data processing software, it knows how many images it needs to capture. If you turn on 3D mode, it'll do that 3D crosshatch all in one nice plan for you. You also can adjust the survey angle if you don't like that angle. Turn off auto, and then you can adjust the survey angle. It'll rotate the whole plan for you. Once you hit go, it'll take off, and it'll go and map out that mission. In the event you run out of battery, you'll be able to pick up where your drone left off. Okay. Any questions on that, guy?
No questions, Brandon.
Sweet. Last but not least, we have our waypoint and orbit missions. So this is something else that y'all can select. He put it all into one. So if he wanted to show that you can do multi missions, you can do that. So he's going to start out with a waypoint mission, and then he's going to add another flight plan. So if you want to do a waypoint and then stop and then go into an orbit, or if you want to go into a survey and then go into orbit, or if you want to go into a sector search and then go into waypoint, you can stack the missions in flight planning. So all you have to do, instead of saying return to home or hover, you can go next action. So we do have that feature built into our software as well. Okay. So what DroneSense will do is whenever you fly, it'll go through and it'll snap all of those photos for you, or you can tell it to not snap photos if you're doing a search and rescue type operation. But if you're wanting to do data processing, the mapping features that we have in our software will ingest into any of the data processing options available to you. So you can utilize Pix4D Matic, DJI Terra, ArcGIS iScan, DroneDeploy, any type of soft data processing software you'd like to use. To make sure that you're successful, there are certain things that you want to take into account. Proper overlap, whether type of camera system that you may be utilizing, and ground sampling distance. So first, we're going to talk about proper overlap. Whenever you're doing that that overlap, going back into the survey mission, right, we have the ability to go in and set the overlap here by clicking on overlaps. So if you were to go into that one, you'll notice that there's these waypoint lines here as he gets higher in altitude. That's going to make sure that there is enough of one image overlapping the next image, overlapping the next image. And what that does is when Pix4D or any of the other software systems, they'll look at every photo, right? And they'll say, okay, that is the same thing in all of these photos. I know what those things are and I know where they are on the Earth. And so what will end up happening is by making sure you have that proper overlap, it makes your maps more accurate. So what you'll notice, like it, for example, in like Pix4D React, it doesn't need as much data. And so what will happen is sometimes you'll see the road will just end and then it'll be like snapped over just a little bit and then it'll pick up where you left off. It's just because there just either A, wasn't enough overlap or enough things in the pictures for it to know where it goes. Okay. So make sure that you have set the proper overlap. Generally speaking, for Pix4D, for a crash crime scene reconstruction, you're looking at a minimum of 80-70, 80% front overlap, 70% side overlap. I told my drone team to do 90-90 because I can't make data from nothing. So I like to have more data than I need. If I'm doing like a disaster response, I'll bump that guy down to like 60-70. Okay. The next thing you're going to want to pay attention to is, are you running a rolling shutter or a global shutter? Generally speaking, the vast majority of drones are running a rolling shutter sensor. And what'll happen with that is when you take a photo, instead of it doing the entire sensor, it does it in sections. So if you're flying too fast, it can cause distortion in your final maps. So if you're running a rolling shutter sensor, which is the vast majority of them, just fly a little bit slower when you're doing your data collection. Conversely, you have the global shutter or mechanical shutter sensor as well. So these are going to be some of the bigger sensors, like your P1 camera sensor or the Mavic 3E has a global shutter, your old Phantom 4s or the X4S if you're going really old. All of those have those global shutters. And as you'll notice on the left-hand side, the entire picture is taken at one time. So with those sensors, you can fly a lot faster. So it's easier on the data collection side. One of the things that I like to really highlight is, I don't know if I have it or not, if you were to take a photo or a video of something that's moving very fast, like a propeller or a vehicle wheel while it's running, what you'll see is you'll see that arcing of the propeller or your arcing of the wheel. And that's because that shutter is taking it in different points. And so because that thing is moving so fast, you're going to see the arc. Whereas with a global shutter, it'll be one nice single piece. Next, we have ground sampling distance. So projects with high ground sampling distance will have a fewer visual details. In extreme cases, your project will look like an old pixelated video game. So like, for example, on this guy, if I were to fly really high, right, and I were to try to look at those images and zoom down on it, it gets pixelated, right? If I were to fly really low, it would look really good, right? So ground sampling distance is directly related to the altitude. The altitude that you're going to fly these is going to be dependent on what your operation is. For example, if it's a disaster response and I'm doing a mapping mission for that, I'm going to fly really high. I don't care to find a ground. Like I'm not looking for gouge marks on roadways. I'm not looking for a shell casing. I'm looking, is the house up or is the house down? Right. And so I can fly super high. I'm not worried about ground sampling distance. But if you're mapping for crime scenes and you want to find that shell casing, you got to fly low so that you can have that high resolution imagery. This is another example of that. In our software, you have the ability to adjust ground sampling distance, and it'll tell you your inches per pixel. And what that means is from the center point of one pixel, if you were to zoom all the way down to the center point of the next pixel, that's that distance, 0.3 of an inch. So again, as you get higher and higher, that distance gets bigger and bigger, lower resolution photos, right? So take that into account as well. If you're flying in an area that has topography, like in my area, I don't have to worry about that at all. But in other areas of the United States, y'all do. So if you're going to be flying in an area that has topography, you want to make sure that you're tracking that ground sampling distance. One thing that you'll notice in the videos that we showed a little bit earlier, it has terrain following in that vid in those mapping missions. So great news there. You don't have to make multiple flight plans. But in the event that you aren't running terrain following, make sure that you are not setting the altitude at one altitude for the entire operational area. If you have high hills, you're going to have low ground sampling distance. If you're in the valley, it's going to be a high ground sampling distance. So you have low resolution in the valleys, high resolution in the hills. So sometimes for that kind of stuff, you'll have to break up the flight plans. Any questions on the stuff I covered so far? I went kind of quick through that.
Hey, Brennan, Matt Rowland submitted one, and I think this was a few minutes ago. He said, any plans to allow the drone to stop and take photos? So, no. Matt, I'm not sure.
Yeah, so Pix4D has an option called safe mode where the drone looks like it has Tourette's and it just stops at every single waypoint and keeps on going. So to my knowledge, no, we don't have any plans to do that. There's not a lot of really good application to that. It doesn't work in night mapping. If you're wanting to do night maps, generally speaking, you have to stop, take the photo, and let that shutter close. And that shutter closing time is going to be variable based off of how much light you're throwing at that specific scene. So like safe mode, in my experience, does not work for crash reconstruction doing night mapping. Typically for night mapping, I like to utilize video for that. But there's bunch of different ways to skin the cat for night mapping. But safe mode, as they called it in Pix4D, we don't have that built out, and I don't think it's on the roadmap.
Thanks, man.
Great question, Matt. Any others? Happy to field them, guys. Training opportunity. Don't be shy. Awesome. So when you're mapping, some of the things you want to take into consideration as well is that, generally speaking, these data processing softwares like to have heterogeneous areas to map out, right? So you want some stuff for the software to look at, stuff to say, okay, that's the same thing and all of those things. You want non-reflective surfaces. So if you were to try to map out a lake or if you were to try to map out an ice rink, it's going to struggle. Static scenes, you always want to make sure that there's not a whole lot of movement, because again, it takes those photos, it looks at each one of those photos, and it says, okay, those are the same thing in every single one of those photos. Well, if those things are moving, it's not able to process that very well. So if it's a crash scene, tell everybody, hey, if you don't want to be in the evidence, get out of my scene, and they'll all scatter like roaches. If it's an active roadway, shut the roadway down. You're only going to be mapping for 10 to 20, 30 minutes on a really big scene. It's going to be quick. And then last but not least, simple geometry. When this will really come into account is if you're mapping things like a wildfire burn, right? Like, well, I'm out in the middle of the woods, you know, I'm out in the middle of a field. It's all homogeneous here. But what you have to do for that is you have to fly really high, right? And there's different ways that you can attack that, right? You could fly at 400 feet, because again, for stuff like this, I don't care to find, you know, super high detail stuff. I just want to know, is the house up or down? So you can fly at 400 feet. You can get an SGI authorization and fly at much higher altitudes. Jeff Pritcher, I think, has the record, I think, right now for like 2,000 feet authorization for a wildfire burn. So make sure that they're not homogenous. If you can avoid it, if it is, get really high. Make sure they're not reflective, trying to keep a dynamic scene from not happening. And then complex geometry as well. Okay. From a data processing workflow, you'll start your project. You'll add your images in to whatever data processing software you'll utilize. And then you'll have the aero triangulation phase or the calibration phase for those systems. And then last but not least, you'll get your final products, which is going to be your 2D or 3D reconstructions. And again, DroneSense photos that you take with your software or with the drone can process into any of these. Some of the final products that you'll get is a 2D orthomosaic and a point cloud. That 2D orthomosaic you can ingest into a lot of different softwares, like Caltopo will ingest it, ATAC will ingest it. You can bring it into DroneSense as well. So like if you wanted to map out an area and then bring in that imagery file, if you have the geo the geo package added onto your account, you'll have the ability to ingest those 2D orthomosaics. You also can bring in point clouds as well, which are really great for a lot of different applications. So for example, this is a crash scene that we did that was mapped in DroneSense. Then we used the data collection points for the GPS to be able to get very accurate measurements. Everything in this orthomosaic was accurate to 2 centimeters. This is a 3D mesh that we did, again, mapped in DroneSense and video, but processed in DJI Terra. So that everything in this one was accurate to 1.2 centimeters. But using those ground control points. So again, by utilizing multiple photographs, you can compute a position in a 3D space utilizing those photos. And that photo, they find out where that point is and located in each image. It figures out the internal and external camera parameters, which is really important when you're going through DroneSense and you're selecting which aircraft you're going to fly or which what camera payload you're wanting to utilize. Make sure you select the right one, because it will mess up things in the data processing if you're selecting the wrong aircraft. Last but not least, you want to make sure that the relative positions and angles of the cameras are tied into the metadata whenever those images are captured, which our software does do that. John asked, does DroneSense allow for RTK ingestion? It does not, from an RTK top hat perspective. But if you're running the Mavic 3E in DroneSense with the, RTK top hat, it's a secondary file anyway. So you can still fly it in DroneSense, run that RTK top hat, and it will still capture those images the way it's supposed to. I'm trying to get more people to request RTK ingestion into DroneSense, but there's just not enough people asking for it to prioritize it. It can be done, but it's just not there yet. Great question, John. So add another ticket. So step one, again, you're going to calibrate. This was a photo of that same crash scene that you saw the orthomosaic for. So it's going to go through, look at all of that crash scene, figure out what's what. It will then create a really rough point cloud, and in that is where you can bring in your accurate measurements with your RTK tower or your scale constraints, things of that nature. Once you've done that, you'll get a highly accurate 2D orthomosaic. Again, you can ingest that into OpsHub. And then you'll also get a 3D point cloud. This is a point cloud from that same crash. Some people have a hard time telling the difference between this and the photo. This is one of our very first scenes that we were mapping out a long time ago. Okay. Again, you can also do relative accuracy checks. So if you're doing this for crash crime scene reconstruction, what I like to do is I like to paint known measurements in my scene so that whenever I go back and post and I go through and I measure this stuff out, it's allowed to do really quick check measurements to make sure that it's accurate where you want it to be accurate. It's also really good for the jury. And again, if you fly low enough, you can get you can get crime scene photos as well. So, for example, here's a 9mm shell casing. I was pretty proud of this one because that one measured out at 21mm for this 9mm shell casing, which is awesome. So, real excited about that. Questions, comments, concerns. We got about 15 minutes left. This is the time. What I'll do, guys, we'll go through and I'll unmute everybody. So body cam behavior says being recorded. Matt, I'm looking at you. I'll allow everybody to talk. It automatically goes to mute, just a heads up. So if you have a question or if you want to talk, I know some people have a hard time typing. So if you want to talk, feel free to go in and unmute yourself. And let's have that conversation. I'm making a mistake unmuting Matt. There. And Craig, I think you're the last one. All right, guys. Everybody's allowed to talk at this point. Tom, good to see you. Fred, good to see you. if y'all have any questions, guys, unmute and feel free to throw those questions my way, man. I'd be more than happy to field them, hypothetical or otherwise, guys. Yeah, that'd be a good one to talk about, Coit. So Coit brought up, he was like, how about the differences between the different processing softwares, right? There's a bunch out there. And they do different things, right? And some of them are really good at some things. Some of them suck at other things. So utilize different systems. Test them all out. Pix4D is the staple. It's the standard for mapping. You could utilize the trial account. It's free. So you can go in and pull up Pix4D Mapper or Pix4D Matic, and you can see what those capabilities are. Pix4D Mapper is the old system. All the features are there, but it really doesn't make very good models, the 3D models. Matic is the more up-to-date version of things. It's missing a few features, but it does have a nice modeler in there, which is really nice. However, one of the things that you need to also pay attention to is DJI Terra makes a fantastic modeler, one of the best I've seen out there. So really, really want to emphasize, try out all the different softwares. Drone Deploy makes a really nice software as well. They're mostly cloud-based. So if you're worried about local processing, which for me, I am, because if you go into a disaster response area, you're not going to have the ability to push up the data sets to process. So I like to be able to see, I like to be able to process everything locally. So try out the different ones. One of the questions that came up from Darren is that for mapping crash scenes, as a general rule, is there a recommended aircraft speed and camera angle for best results? To an extent, yes. So for example, with mapping crash scenes, I don't like to see a ground sampling distance greater than 0.3 of an inch. 0.2, you'll get really nice results from. But we fly crash scenes. We'll do the 2D grid, and then we'll also do orbits around our focal points. And we'll do those at varying altitudes so that we can get really high resolution final products. Some of the things that you want to take into account on the gimbal angle, you want to make sure that you are changing that gimbal angle to best fill your frame with your objective. When you're flying your 2D or 3D grid mission, generally speaking, 70 degrees is good. But when you get down to those orbits, you're going to need to adjust that. When it comes to the speed of flying those systems, you want to make sure that you're not flying too fast if you're running a linear rolling shutter camera system. Granted, all of the softwares have algorithms and corrections in there for adjusting for that, but some of them still struggle with it. So fly slower. Generally speaking, you don't want to see any speed above 11 miles an hour if you're running a linear rolling shutter camera. How do you bridge the grid between the distance of altitude between grid and orbit? You do what's called what I call a ladder, right? So if you're flying your grid for just easy math, because I suck at math, just for easy math examples there, if you're going to fly your grid at, say, 100 feet, right? Just an example. You don't want to fly your first orbit lower than 50% of your grid altitude. So again, if you're at 100 feet, you don't want to have that first orbit lower than 50 feet. And the reason being is all of the software systems have a hard time adjusting for the gimbal change. So to help with that, what we do is we'll fly over the focal point at altitude and take photos every 5 to 10 feet, not a science, down over the focal point to the lowest altitude I want to do an orbit. So for example, if I flew at 100 feet, my first orbit's going to be no less than 50 feet. So I'll probably capture that at 60. And then again, no less than 50% of the next one. So down to 30. So I'll do two orbits at 50, one orbit at 50, one orbit at 30. And then I'll have a ladder taking photos straight down or nadir every 5 to 10 feet to connect the two. Hope that answered your question, Joe. Trying to see if I can pull up a scene real quick for you so I can visually see what it looks like. Any other questions while we're waiting? Craig, Brandon, are you flying all your orbits at the same circumference for 3D modeling? Absolutely not. I fly almost all of those manually, and while I'm a fantastic pilot, I am not that good. And a lot of times, like I said, you can't fly a perfect orbit because those cars crash into a wood line, or they crash into a tree, or they crash into a pole or whatever, right? So you're going to struggle with doing a perfect orbit. So a lot of times they're semicircles, or they're, you know, not even that, right? So like there's a lot of times, goddammit, there's a lot of times that you're just not going to be able to get a full orbit in. Great question. Let's keep them coming, guys. These are good. This is what makes this class fun. Everybody gets to learn from it. While we wait on the next questions, I'll show the next one. I had my screen sharing the whole time. Fantastic. Didn't mean to do that. So here we have, this is Pixportymatic. This is a crash scene from a training that I did up in Minneapolis, with, my training company. If I were to zoom out of this guy, go into 3D, this will allow you to be able to see what my flight plan looks like. So this is what I'm flying. So we have the grid here, right? We have that 2D grid, and then underneath we have the ladder, and then I have my orbit. So that's what my flight plans look like. This is Pixportymatic for those that are curious. Makes it really easy to be able to see what that is. And then the blue deviation is altitude deviation once corrected. So a lot of different options there. This is how I fly my crash scenes. It makes it really easy. Any other questions, guys? Happy to fill them. Is cloud processing as accepted in court as offline processing? Fantastic question. That is going to be highly dependent on the district attorneys for each of y'all's environments. If y'all didn't hear me mumble, is cloud processing acceptable in court? For my agencies, it was not. But we came from a district attorney, one of our district attorneys that was averse to technology. So they wanted everything processed locally. There are a lot of agencies that can process through cloud. So get with your district attorney and figure out what's going to best suit them. Always make sure that it's CJIS compliant, and that there's evidentiary trails, and make sure that all that stuff is actually audited. For me, like I said, I prefer local. I want to keep my evidence. I want to be able to replicate my evidence. I want to be able to submit my own evidence. But there's a lot of agencies out there that's not as high a priority in the concerns there. Do I have a good source/reference for integrating DroneSense into CalTopo? Yeah, his name's John McGraw. He's in this meeting. I personally do not. Coit would probably be a little bit better to talk about CalTopo ingestions. Hopefully you're not on a phone call. But if you are, I'm sure John might be able to answer that one. CalTopo.
I'm going to pass that. We do not currently have a good runway here for going into CalTopo or SARTopo. We're hoping to be able to make that happen. It is on our roadmap, but it's not something we're close at right now.
Yeah. John, I don't know if you have any bandwidth to talk a little bit about it. I'm gonna go with no. So as far as being able to bring them in, as far as being able to bring in the KMLs and things of that nature, I'll show you all how to do that really quick. Chrome tab, airbase, there we are. So you're just gonna log into your airbase at web.dronesense.com. You'll go to your flights and missions. So again, on the left-hand side, we have flights and missions. And then you'll go to the flight that you want to export out to bring into CalTopo. So what you'll do is you'll pull up the flight. You have export flight path. Click that little guy. There's drop downs. You have KML, GeoJSON, JPX. CalTopo likes to take in GPX. Google Earth likes to take in KML. Esri likes to take in GeoJSONs or any of the other three. So feel free to utilize any number of those. For CalTopo, you'll just click that little guy. You'll confirm it. It'll download the JPX file, and then you'll be able to ingest that into CalTopo. How you do that, I unfortunately don't know. But we'll work on an ingestion side of the house for you. Great question. We got 3 minutes left, guys. Any other questions? Coy, do you have the exit QR code thing, or are we still doing it that way?
Yes. Let me see if I can grab it real quick. Stand by.
Sorry, I didn't have that. Any other questions while he does that? Hardware, software, regulations, any of those? All right, guys, if y'all don't mind, kind of still try to hang out for a little while longer so that Coy can throw up the registration QR code or the exit QR code so that y'all can get your certificates for y'all's time. Hey, Brandon, I really appreciate it. Yep, go ahead.
What's the best way to put that up? I've got a Google Drive, a Google Doc. I guess I could share my screen, perhaps?
Yeah, I would share a screen.
Yeah, stand by one.
Yep, not a problem. While you get ready for that, I'm going to share one more thing. Slideshow. Share this tab instead. One other thing that I want to really highlight, guys, is always. Oh, there you go. Quick, got it up before I did. Nice. Make sure that y'all scan that QR code, guys, for your basic training certificates. Fill out all the information that you need to. I'll leave this up for a couple of minutes, and then I have one last thing that I want to highlight, and then we'll be off to the races. We'll give you all back your day.
Everybody good on that? Anybody not good on it?
Yeah, if you're not good, hit the raise your hand. We'll give it a little bit longer.
Oops. All right.
Still showing on my own quite. You're good.
Okay.
All right. And last but not least, the very last slide that I have. If you're not familiar with this page, you should be. So again, it's support.dronesense.com, support.dronesense.com, support.dronesense.com. If y'all have any issues, any questions, feel free to go to that webpage. We have all kinds of stuff. You can type in sector search. You could type in survey. You could type in orbits. You could type in mission planning. All of it is going to populate there for a support article that are public safety, police, and firefighter friendly with pictures that you can't really mess up. In the event that that's still an issue or you're not able to find or you don't have the time to search for it, call that phone number at 833-DS-HELP-5. Again, that's 833-DS-HELP-5. That's a 24/7 support line that's based here in the United States. The vast majority of the people who answer those phone lines come from public safety. So we're not afraid to answer those phone calls at 3 o'clock in the morning with you on whatever incident that you have. So please don't hesitate to call. There's not a dumb question. There's not a, like, I don't want to feel bad. Like you gotta call us if you're having issues. That's why you're here. You're paying the big bucks for it. So make sure that y'all are utilizing that. And then you always have help@dronesense.com as well if you need to send it up for any questions, comments, concerns that you may have.
Brandon, I want to speak to that just real quick before they go.
Yeah, go ahead, please.
Hey, a lot of you, man, you know, on a sincere side here is, I know Brandon's on the same position, is that you guys will call us and hit us up on text because we got you know, really good relationships with everybody. And our intentions are to make sure we get these tickets dropped in here and get the support site, push things forward to the engineers. But I was just looking for that one that John McGraw, John, that you sent when you tagged us whenever we did the I think it was during one of our Friday work groups, and I just looked, we don't have a ticket in there for you for that, for the star patterns with the altitudes. Or no, it was Matt. It was Matt. But
Matt.
John had mentioned it earlier. And this is just a real good example. Like, I had every intention, and then I saw a squirrel, and I went the other direction. So, like, if you guys can, please drop those tickets in there. At the help at DroneSense, I just drop an email and say, hey, this is what I need. This is what I'm seeing. Because it really does help us make sure that we can get everything out to you guys, and we don't drop the ball on you. We just got a lot going on.
Fantastic, guys. Really appreciate everybody's time. Again, please do not hesitate to reach out if y'all have any questions. That's why we're here. We want to make sure that y'all are successful or whatever event that y'all are responding to or supporting. So get out there, give it a shot, try out those mapping features, be safe, fly safe, and we'll see y'all on the next one.
See you guys. Thanks. Bye.